You're back and you're watching News Channel 3 live at 9. One woman is using her pass to make sure that others do not end up in human trafficking.
Yeah, that's right. So Kemba Smith Pradia is here with Tracy Branch to share their story. And good morning to both of you,
good
for
morning.
Starters. And for starters, for viewers who may not know, just really recap what happened.
My story isn't of human trafficking. I basically was a college student, got involved in an abusive relationship with a drug dealer. And as a first-time nonviolent drug offender, I got sentenced to 24 and a half years in federal prison. And even though the prosecutor said I never handled, used, or sold any of the drugs that were involved, I still was 23, sentenced to longer than I had actually been living on this earth. And so I was pregnant at the time, gave birth to my son while I was incarcerated. And long story short, President Clinton granted me executive clemency in December 2000 because there was a huge amount of support for my freedom. And I was released, and I've been out on the circuit sharing my story, being very transparent about the choices and getting youth to understand the consequences, but also advocating for policy reform.
I wanted to ask the two of you about those choices, because these days we're hearing so much about human trafficking, or the sex slave industry, as some people also call it. How pervasive is it today, Tracy?
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is very pervasive. I work as a supervisory special agent with the FBI, and I manage a unit, a civil rights task force. And I can tell you that on a daily basis, we get some type of lead, tip, or request to investigate a human trafficking situation. Predominantly, what we see are domestic citizens, which are just people from where you live that are get involved in those situations. Typically, the victims represent a vulnerability, whether it's poverty. We have a lot of individuals that run away, that are in foster care, or that otherwise have situations at home, like drug addiction, homelessness. And so they do represent very vulnerable categories.
And while you were incarcerated, your family took care of your son.
Yes.
And
correct.
You're very fortunate to have resources behind you to be able to fight for you. Not everybody has that, though. And I know you want to be the voice for so many who are still locked up for not the proper reasons.
Right. And in particular, talk to youth about the importance of self-confidence, loving themselves, so they will make those healthy choices and have some safeguards and cautions so they won't go down the path of human trafficking. And to be quite honest, people don't look for that path. There are environments where they are victims to that path. But I'm very grateful for the support, and I just, you know, encourage people that have been involved in human trafficking that there needs to be support and counseling for them in coming out, and for people not to be judgmental of their experience, because some people may think, you know, they're fast, they're promiscuous, but when they've abruptly been brought into this environment and victimized, that there be counseling to help them as they come out. And for me, counseling was very important upon my release, and making sure, because my crime was I chose the wrong relationship.
Tracy, that's one thing I wanted to ask you. Is there enough support out there these days? Because it's one thing for many to be involved in a situation of human trafficking, but a lot of people will wonder, is there a way out? And is it the support there that's going to be needed for them?
I can tell you that there are a lot of non-governmental organizations, many of which the FBI partner with to try to meet some of the needs that these victims have, whether it's therapy, housing, job training. But unfortunately, there's much to yet be done to help these individuals. For every girl that we're able to rescue, I am certain that there are probably 50 that we can't reach. And they're just disconnects. I was sharing this morning with Kemba that, you know, if you have a young child that is a runaway and they've never been reported as a runaway, how do we know to look for them?
Exactly. Talk to us also for those right here in Memphis in the Mid-South. We hear about a problem like this, an issue like that, like this, and a lot of us may assume this is not going to happen here in Memphis. It's not a huge problem in the Mid-South area, is it?
I can tell you that it is evolving. I had the unfortunate opportunity to work the very first human trafficking case that was worked in this district back in 2006. And since that time, I could at one point tell you verbatim how many cases there were. At this point, that is an impossibility because it's just very, very rampant. And if I had to make suggestions of what people could do, mentorship is huge because there's so many children from broken homes, from divided homes that are in foster care that just do not have positive role models, especially positive relationships with male role models that are appropriate. And so if you have an opportunity to get into any type of mentorship situation, whether it's through an NGO or through your church or nonprofit, whatever it is, I would strongly encourage
And I'm grateful that the links here of Memphis have brought me back a second time, because I do think human stories can have an impact in giving people inspiration and hope to, you know, change things around or just not to lose hope. So I'm grateful to be able to be back, to be able to share my story here in this community.
And thank
Don't
you for being
lose hope for sure.
Yes.
Open about everything.
Tracy, thank you as well. We appreciate everything the both of you are doing.
Thank you.
All right.